Yeah, we are live now. You can continue.
A warm and beautiful evening to all present here. I, Toshani Gupta, along with Sanmeet Singh, are the moderators for the evening. And it is a great pleasure for us to welcome you all to the International Virtual Colloquium of Healthcare Students MedInvade 2021. The conference brings forth a global platform to encourage healthcare students from all around to expand their horizons when it comes to medicine and research, while also exchanging the gained knowledge in a universal manner. The current session deals with the topic, India's fight against the COVID-19 pandemic, what we need to know. It gives me immense pleasure to introduce our speaker for the event, Honorable Dr. Chandrakant Laheria, sir. Sir is a physician, epidemiologist, vaccinologist, public health and policy expert, as well as a writer. His work centers around strengthening health systems, public policy interventions to address healthcare inequities, and to develop innovative models for health service delivery. He has been considered as one of the credible voices of reason during COVID-19 pandemic in India. In early 2008, Sir joined the World Health Organization in India, where for the next few years, he coordinated the organization's work on the new vaccine introduction in the country. He specifically worked on formulation of national vaccine policy of India and on the introduction of Haemophilus influenzae type B vaccine, as well as to scale up hepatitis B vaccination across the Indian states. Sir is the lead author of the book, Till We Win, India's Fight Against the COVID-19 Pandemic, with Dr. Randeep Guleria from AIIMS New Delhi and Dr. Gagandeep Kang of Christian Medical College, Vellore. The book has become a bestseller. In the year 2012, Sir received ICMR's Dr. B.C. Srivastava Foundation Award for his work on translating community-based health research into public policy interventions. In 2005, he became the youngest fellow ever elected to the Indian Public Health Association. In October 2020, in a study conducted by Stanford University and published in the reputed PLOS Biology, Laheria Sir was listed among the top 2% of researchers globally in the fields of pediatrics and public health. Sir's seminal paper titled A Brief History of Vaccines and Vaccination in India was published in the Indian Journal of Medical Research, and this paper is one of the highly cited as well as amongst the most comprehensive and authoritative published articles on vaccines and vaccination in India. Having such an esteemed personality amongst us today, it's truly an honor. We welcome you, sir. I would now request sir to take. So I would request you to take over this session and share your wisdom with all of us. And at any point, if the audience members have any questions, they can put those in the chat box, and we will get to them at the end of the presentation. So over to you, sir.
Thank you. Thank you, Toshani. Thanks, Tarun, and thanks entire SMR team for inviting me. It's indeed a pleasure and it's an honor to speak to students. I personally believe that whenever, no matter who the person is, talking to a younger generation, a younger students, it's a two-way learning. And that learning happens in something like osmosis, without realizing that we pass on some knowledge, but we learn from them a lot. So it's always a pleasure, honor to speak and talk to the students, and I'm really honored to be here. Without further ado, I request the team to put the slides on the screen. So in next 30 minutes or so, I'm going to focus about the core theme of today's discussion, which is about COVID-19 pandemic and India's fight. What all we have learned and what all we need to know to navigate through this pandemic. Next slide, please.
Yes, sir.
Next slide. Yeah, so this is the book which Toshani was talking about. I have co-authored with Dr. Randeep Guleria and Dr. Gagandeep Kang. This was available since December 2020. And some of the points which I'll be discussing, deliberating in this talk have been taken from this book. But we know that this book was written immediately after first wave of pandemic. So it has a very different perspective. But since then, a number of things have changed. So what I'll do in this conversation, this talk, I'll capture both components. Next slide, please. So when we start talking about COVID-19 pandemic, it will be incomplete to without speak without the context. And the context is in the next slide, where I discuss what is the current scenario of COVID-19 in India and the world. We know from the start of pandemic, which was declared on 11th March 2020, there have been around 18.7 crore cases globally and 40 lakh deaths since the start of the pandemic. This is globally 40 lakh deaths, 18.7 crore cases. In India, the country has reported around 3.08 crore cases and 407,000 deaths since the start of the pandemic. When we talk about what is happening currently, India is reporting around 42,700 New Delhi cases. This was the number for New Delhi cases yesterday. This is around 8% of the global cases. Globally, around the same day, on the same day, around 492,000 New Delhi cases were reported. If we talk about number of deaths, India reported around 1,260 deaths yesterday. This is a weekly average of those deaths. And globally, the number of deaths reported is around 8,465. So India is around reporting one in every seven deaths. So that's the scenario. There was a point of time in the second wave in April and May when India reported nearly one third to half of the global cases and almost similar proportion of deaths. So country has witnessed a pandemic and second wave, which was really severe. In the next slide, we see the number of cases reported in India since the start of the pandemic.
Yes, sir. Like, sorry to interrupt. Like, I cannot keep it full slide because my laptop will hang. So that's why I'm continuing in this mode.
So, sure. So next slide. In the next slide, what we are seeing is the emergence of the number of cases, daily cases reported since the start of the pandemic. And this slide shows the comparison between United States, United Kingdom, and India. That you see those that epidemic curve where different color codes are shown, and you would see that India witnessed the second wave, which was ferocious and far bigger than any other country witnessed. There was a sharp spike in the cases, and this happened during April and May. All other countries also witnessed a severe wave, but none of the country experienced the kind of wave which India experienced. So that's a pattern. Other countries witnessed multiple waves, which were smaller. India witnessed two waves, but second wave was really ferocious. Next slide, please. As far as deaths are concerned, the deaths were also relatively high in the country. And this is a pattern which we have seen. We move to the next one. In any pandemic or any situation, the key is that we learn from it. So in next few slides, I derive a few learning that what are the early learnings and reflection. So we are prepared for the future. And one of the key learning from this pandemic is that people's participation is so very essential and one of the important pillar of pandemic response and health services. Now we know that in this pandemic, the key measures which have been taken were non-pharmacological intervention, which essentially means face mask, hand washing, and physical distancing. Now public health and medical fraternity indicated that these are the interventions which should be done. But these interventions need to be undertaken by citizen people. So their participation in responding to the pandemic is so essential. And that's what the pandemic showed, that we require participation of people to ensure success of any health intervention. Even on the test, the treatment, the contact tracing, even in those services, the participation of citizen is very essential. When people fall sick, they develop symptoms, they need to get themselves tested. So no matter what kind of testing services or facility you create, unless those facilities or services are ready, unless people participate in them, it will not work. So testing is dependent upon people's participation. Contact tracing is dependent upon people providing the kind of information which we need. Even the treatment, the good treatment outcome is dependent upon people seeking early treatment. So at every stage of healthcare services, it is so very essential that people, citizens, participate in the process for the success of that intervention. And that's what we have learned from once again from this pandemic. The key difference in many of the countries, Europe, United States, especially if you are following pandemic from last year, much of the second or third waves in European countries was because many of the citizens in those settings were not adhering to COVID appropriate behavior. They were not wearing face masks, not maintaining physical distancing, and that's how it happened. But many of the Asian countries, at least before till Delta variant emerged, were doing relatively better, because in Asian countries, there is a habit and culture of mask wearing, physical distancing, or following the government guidelines. So the difference in USA, Europe, and Asian setting was much dependent upon the citizen participation in this process. So difference in epidemic curve was largely associated with the citizen behavior and adoption of non-pharmacological intervention, till more recently when Delta variant, which is more transmissible, emerged. And some of these learnings can be used for silent pandemics or such as non-communicable disease. Next slide. The other learning which we have derived from this pandemic is that effective pandemic response requires three-way partnership. It's not enough that doctors are doing something or health facilities are doing something. It's important that policymakers, the elected leaders and administrators, take the right kind of decision. This empower and support the health services. Similarly, the technical, medical, and public health expert work together to design the right kind of policies, treatment guidelines, and then those involved in hospital services are deliver healthcare services. It's also equally important that communities are involved in the process. Like if people do not follow COVID appropriate behavior, no amount of healthcare services will be enough. So our learning is that policymakers, technical experts, medical and public health, and communities need to work together. And this is another example. In the interest of time, I'm not going into this, but we know that in some countries where all three worked together, outcome was far better. And Dharavi in Mumbai is one such example. Difference in inter-epidemic curve was associated between these three factors. Next slide, please. Then the pandemic has also taught us that healthcare is not just medical care. And now this is a crucial difference. The medical care is when people become sick, they need hospitalization, they are seen by doctors, attended when they are admitted in facility. That's a medical care. But pandemic has taught us that medical care, focus merely on medical care, will not solve the problem. Not definitely not in the pandemic. But in general also, even for non-communicable diseases, many other diseases, if people adopt healthier lifestyle, if health services, health system deliver them the right kind of preventive advice, healthy health promotion behavior, to help them maintain good health, and that's a public health services. So public health and medical care makes the health care. The hospital services are all medical care, and no system should focus upon medical care only. We know that United States is mainly a medicalized care system. The cost of healthcare is very high. People have many health conditions and they are not prevented, and that's why the healthcare system is overburdened and it's expensive. So to convert medical care system into a healthcare system, essentially that system require a well-functioning primary healthcare facility where outpatient services are provided, where preventive promotive health services are provided. And such systems are also well designed to quickly adapt to respond to epidemics and pandemics. Health services, healthcare also means a broad range of healthcare services, which means preventive services, promotive services, curative or treatment services, diagnostic, rehabilitative, palliative. All of these services are required. But often when we talk about medical care or healthcare, we focus upon only medical or curative services and diagnostic services. Now, this pandemic has also taught us that both government and private health systems are required to deliver services effectively. We know that in the early part of pandemic, there was not that much attention on inputs from the private system. Mainly government healthcare system started functioning. Then slowly private healthcare system started opening up, providing curative services, treatment services, and diagnostic services. But in the second wave of pandemic, it was mainly the private sector which provided most of the curative services. So both systems are required, but a stronger government healthcare system is essential to deliver the public health services which do not come from private sector. And of course, we have learned the role of public-private partnership in development of PPE kit, testing kits and vaccine development. Now, jumping to the what is happening now and the second wave, the COVID-19 pandemic in India, new strains, third wave and children, some of the key discussion. So we know on the next slide that there are a new strains or variants of SARS-CoV-2 virus, SARS-CoV-2 virus, which is an ancestral virus, first identified in Wuhan on 31st December 2019. Since then, there have been mutations in the virus. And we know that mutations is a normal phenomena in various viruses, especially RNA virus, which this is, where some minor changes. So every mutation in the virus is not significant or relevant. But there are some mutations which can cause the change in the characteristic of the virus. So if a mutation increase the transmissibility of virus, or it results in immune escape, which essentially means that somebody who had previous infection, but the new mutation or the mutation can cause the person to be infected again. So that is immune escape. Or if a mutation cause breakthrough infection, which essentially means people who are vaccinated can still get infected with the mutated or newer strain or newer variants. Or if a mutation and resulting variant cause severe disease. So three broad things. One is increased transmissibility or change in the transmissibility, immune escape or breakthrough infection, or severe disease. If any of these three or more than one of these happens, then that variant is called variant of concern. So till now, in the world, four variants of concerns have been identified. One such variant of concern is Delta variant B1617.2. This was first reported from India. So this has a higher transmissibility, some immune escape or breakthrough infection, but we don't really know, and there is no evidence from India that it caused severe disease, but transmissibility is higher. So there are four variants of concern. The Delta plus variant, which was we are hearing AY.1, is a subcomponent, some part of the Delta only. So it's not a different variant of concern, but since it's related to Delta, that's why it is also called variant of concern in India. Then there are some variants of interest. Now, if a mutation is identified in the virus, and there is a possibility that this could cause increased transmissibility, immune escape, breakthrough infection, or severe disease, but this is not proven, but only there is early indication that there is a potential of this, then those are designated as variants of interest. Now here there are six variants of interest, but there is another one which has been added by World Health Organization, Lambda variant of interest on 14th of June. So there are seven variants of interest, which essentially means there is no such characteristic which is currently of worry, but they need to be watched and additional studies should be done. So there are four variants of concern and seven variants of interest globally. So I have already discussed that when a variant is considered or called a variant of concern. On the next slide, the data from Delhi is shown. In that data, what you see that this data is for which were the commonest variant during the period of November 2020 to April 2021. And then you will see this Firozi color on the last bar is a Delta variant. So slowly, like what you see that there was a different, not so relevant variant circulating November, December, January, in light pinkish color was commonest variant in February and March. So that is Alpha variant, while the commonest variant in Delhi, this is Delhi specific data, in February and March, and all of a sudden Delta variant become a most common variant circulating in Delhi, and that caused the second national wave in India, now we know, but that wave was fourth wave for Delhi. So Delta become one of the commonest variant, and that's the reason we should keep tracking and doing genomic sequencing to understand the variant. Next slide, please. We have discussed that Delta plus has emerged. Delta plus has emerged not only from India, but 12 other countries. But till now, there is no evidence that Delta plus variant is any different from Delta variant, except there are some early indication that Delta plus variant has one additional mutation K417N, which has some potential to show some resistance against monoclonal combination antibody therapy, but it's not immediate concern. So Delta plus is unlikely to be any different from Delta and not an immediate concern. But what is important that all the new emerging variant should be tracked and watched. Yesterday you might have read, or today morning you might have read in the newspapers that Kappa variant two cases were reported from one state of India. But we need to remember that Kappa variant is also sublineage of Delta variant CB1.617, which was reported from India. So it's not new. So every new variant which is reported from any setup should not be cause of alert. We should be careful in that. Next slide. Now, moving to the other part, that COVID-19 vaccine pandemic in India, what is happening on the vaccine? So by now, Indian government has approved four vaccines: Covishield, Covaxin, Sputnik V, and Moderna. Covishield is manufactured by Oxford AstraZeneca, and this is a two-dose vaccine currently administered at the interval of 12 to 16 weeks. This is the second Covishield vaccine is a viral vectored vaccine. Essentially, what happens in this vaccine that the antigenic portion of SARS-CoV-2 from a spike protein is taken, pick the genomic sequence of that part is taken and inserted into a chimpanzee adenovirus. Now, chimpanzee adenovirus do not have an ability to cause any illness in human. Adenovirus are very common, as you might have already read by now. Now, there are human adenovirus also. So these adenovirus cause very mild common cold, but this is a chimpanzee adenovirus which cause common cold in chimpanzee, not in human beings. So on that adenovirus, a particular section which is antigenic is incorporated, and then that makes the vaccine. So this vaccine provide immunity but without risk of disease. So that's a Covishield vaccine recommended at the gap of 12 to 16 weeks. It's a viral vector platform. No vaccine before this vaccine was developed on this platform. Sputnik V is also the same platform, but Sputnik V use human adenovirus portion. AD5 and AD26 are used in this vaccine. So that is also two-dose vaccine. There is another Sputnik light vaccine coming, which is single-dose vaccine. Covishield efficacy when given at 12 to 16 weeks interval is around 79%. Sputnik efficacy, Sputnik recommended at 3 to 13 weeks of interval, efficacy is around 92%. Covaxin is an Indian vaccine manufactured by Indian Council of Medical Research and Bharat Biotech. This is inactivated vaccine given at the interval of 4 to 6 weeks. The efficacy of this vaccine when both shots are given is around 78%. Moderna is another vaccine which has been licensed in India, but currently not available. This is a mRNA-based vaccine, messenger RNA-based vaccine. And again, this is another platform on which no vaccine in the past have been used. There are many other vaccines which are likely to come to India. Zycop-D is a DNA-based vaccine. Once it is licensed, it will become world's first DNA vaccine for any human illness. No vaccine on DNA platform, DNA plasmid platform, that's approach been developed. So there are many vaccines coming in the country. Next slide. When it comes to vaccination, we know that India has a relatively slower pace of vaccination when it comes to the vaccination of entire population. However, by now, India has vaccinated more number of people than any other part of the world. Till now, around 5% of Indian population has received both shots, and around 18% of Indian population has received single shot, or 22% of Indian population has received either one or two, at least one shot. That number is fairly high, like the absolute number are low in the other countries. But the number of the proportion of population which has received at least one shot in UK and United States is fairly high, but India is making progress in this direction. Next. One of the key questions which people ask, how long the immunity lasts after vaccination or natural infection? One of the papers said that after natural infection, person can be protected up to 6 to 11 months and maybe longer. We really don't know, but at least 11 months, 6 to 11 months, people will be protected after natural infection. Same is being considered about the vaccination. So currently vaccines are being administered, but none of the country is considering like some are considering, but none of the country had decided about booster shot. So one of the question is that booster shot may be required, but we really don't know when. At least 1 year of the protection will be there, and before after that we will know. Other part is that individual who developed COVID-19 disease, natural infection, are recommended to wait for, by as per Government of India guideline, at least for 3 months before they get vaccinated. WHO say that they can wait for 6 months after natural infection to get vaccinated. In the vaccines, if you receive first shot, no matter what is the gap to receive second shot, you should take your shot. So like, for example, if a person is supposed to receive vaccine at 12 weeks of interval, but due to any reason he fails to receive the vaccine at 12 weeks, then that person can take vaccine any time. Like whenever the person will take the second shot, that shot will be counted. The first shot need not to be repeated. If somebody develop natural infection after receiving vaccine, then person doesn't have to worry. Like follow the same principle. Like once you develop natural infection, wait for 3 months to get your second shot. There are dialogues and discussions that whether one shot of vaccine or whether individual who were naturally infected should receive one vaccine, one shot only. Those are discussion. Current recommendation is that everybody should receive two shots. The principle to follow that keep the recommended gap. If you develop natural infection, then wait for 3 months. If after receiving first shot, you get develop natural infection, then also wait for 3 months. So that's the approach. Some of the vaccines are being considered or being shown to have a less effectiveness against emerging variants. What we need to remember that the current focus of India's vaccination program is reducing hospitalization and death. And it has been found that even single shot of at least some vaccines, Covishield vaccine, which is the commonest vaccine being administered in India, provide 71% effectiveness against moderate to severe illness. So people need not to worry that the gap between second shot is longer. They can get vaccine, single shot provide protection, but everybody need to get both shots of vaccine to be protected. On the next slide, I show that now Government of India recommend vaccine for pregnant women, lactating women. In pregnancy, there is a higher risk of severe disease, even preterm delivery. This is evidence coming from different parts of the world. That's why it's recommended that pregnant women should get vaccine, follow the same schedule. Somebody who is planning to get pregnant, they should get vaccine before planning for pregnancy, but they can get vaccine any point of time. Lactating women should also get vaccine. This is recommended for them. It is considered that if they get vaccine, immunoglobulin A are secreted in the breast milk, and that can provide some benefit to breastfeeding child also. Vaccines are effective against emerging variants, and booster dose is not recommended. Currently, the vaccination of children is not recommended in India. In some parts of the world, 12 to 17 years of age group adolescents are being vaccinated, not in India. So we hope. So I'm sorry, there was some connection issue. So this is not recommended for vaccination of children is not being done in India, but there are some studies which are going on, and those studies are focused upon clinical trials of children between 2 to 17 years. And once those study reports are, or clinical trial reports are available, the vaccines might be licensed for subsequent additional population groups. Next slide, please. So there is a lot of discussion that third wave would happen, when third wave would happen, and whether it would affect children. In the next slide, I show what happened in 1918-1920 influenza pandemic in India. And in this pandemic, you would see that these are the graphs for, or line diagrams for epidemic curves, so to be more precise, for various provinces of then British India. It shows that second wave was really ferocious. So the first wave is between April 1918 to June 1918, very small. But across the country, the second wave was really big. And so usually in such kind of infectious disease, second waves are really big. And that's what was repeated in India in this wave, this pandemic also. On the next slide, when the third wave would happen is dependent upon a few factors. So this is dependent upon the waning immunity. Like majority of the people who got infected, during the second wave in April and May. And we believe that natural immunity lasts for 6 to 9 months. So it would decline over a period of time. So waning of natural immunity, then how well people are following COVID appropriate behavior, and also new emergence of newer variants, which could be higher transmissible, immune escape, virulence or severity. And also how much is the vaccine coverage, like partial vaccination, full vaccination. So combination of all these factors will determine when the next wave would appear and what would be the extent of next wave. But one thing is clear, that if people keep following COVID appropriate behavior from now onward, that will provide some time to increase the vaccination coverage. And if we can hold for some time and with the vaccination coverage and COVID appropriate behavior, the third wave could be delayed. And even the extent or impact of third wave would be very small. So current hope is that if we can wait, because immunity will decline in the period ahead, but if vaccination coverage can be ramped up, and if third wave could come around November 2021, and it is likely to be far smaller, very relatively smaller than second wave, and could be really around 100,000 case daily cases in a day. But it depends upon the combination of these factors. If there is a newer strain which is higher transmissible, it could be higher. If vaccination coverage could be relatively higher by November, it would be smaller. So there are multiple unknowns. But what people need to remember, that what is happening in hill stations now, that there is a crowding, then there is no reason to believe that virus would not spread. We have seen in United Kingdom that even after vaccination, the infection is spreading. But fortunately, since they are vaccinated, the people in United Kingdom are vaccinated, that's why the infections are happening, but the people are not getting sick. But that is not the scenario in India, because in India, people are not vaccinated. So that's going to be a challenge. So people need to be mindful, and these four factors will determine. In some localized settings, the wave can come a little earlier. On the next slide, I show one of the pieces which I published. And this piece is about the rumor and the ill-informed scientific news that third wave would affect children. So there is no scientific evidence that third wave or any subsequent wave would affect children. We know through sero survey that children have been proportionately infected in the second wave or first wave. There is no change. Like out of all the COVID-19 confirmed cases in India, between the age group of 0 to 10 years, there were 3% of the total cases. Now we need to remember that in 0 to 10 years, the population around 18 to 20%. So in comparison of their population, the proportion of cases in 0 to 10 years was really small. Similarly, 11 to 18 years population is around same 15 to 18%, and the number of cases in that population was 8%. So proportion of cases, in spite of the similar rate of infection in children, has been really low, and there is no reason to believe that children would be severely affected in third wave. And now there is a clarity. Now I want to highlight one of the things which why children do not get infected, develop severe disease. So this virus infects everybody in the same way, nasopharynx, back of the nose and throat. But to cause severe disease, the virus need to latch upon, go into our lungs through a receptor called angiotensin conversion enzyme 2, ACE2 receptor. Now, fortunately, these receptors are really underdeveloped in children. So that's why if children do develop similar kind of infection, and they do not develop a severe disease, and that's a very good thing, at least for children's perspective. Now, some people started arguing that because adults are getting vaccinated, that's why children would be affected in third wave. So this is a data from United States from now, December 2020 to May 2021, rather June 2021. During this period, United States increased vaccination coverage, and this data showed that even with the increased vaccination coverage, the proportion of disease or severe disease in children was not changed. So we can be confident that children will not be affected unless there is something which is unknown, but that will be applicable for all population. There is no need to believe that children would be affected. Next slide, please. So after two waves in India, are we any wiser? What our learnings are? There are a few silver linings. There are a few good things that there is a new attention on health at all levels, from political leadership to the state governments and among us people also. There is a discourse on strengthening public health services, government health facilities in India. There is attention on renewed need for mental health services. in the country, the teleconsultation have been legalized, which is a good development. It will make health services accessible. India has shown that when required, how ramping up hospital beds and testing capacity can help self-sufficiency in the personal protective equipment and testing kits. India has shown the research and development, especially vaccines and testing kits. The vaccine development in India and world in the 1 year or 15 months have progressed so much that this progress could have happened only in a decade or even longer. So it has really made a leapfrog. And we have learned and formed the new partnership and collaboration between policymakers, health experts, and community members. But the key thing is that any pandemic or any learning or any challenge is incomplete if we don't learn from it. So this is a book by economics Nobel laureate Angus Deaton. In this book, The Great Escape, Health, Wealth, and Origin of Inequality, he studied the cholera pandemic of 19th century and influenza pandemic of 20th century. And he has argued that much of the economic development and growth in European nation is attributable because after those cholera and influenza pandemic, those countries invested in public health and health services. And that's a learning for India, that India should also, India had not done enough for health services, but now India should invest on health services. Government should do that. And that's how we can prepare our health system for future. So what are the key learnings? Key learning is that prevention is better than cure. So invest in health, invest in prevention. And healthier society need three-way partnership. We require data, the timely and reliable data, and a strong disease surveillance system, which is not really something which we give attention, but we have seen in the pandemic response that without that kind of data, it's almost impossible to fight the diseases, especially infectious diseases. More important that we need to learn from, we means Indian state and governments need to learn from other states, cannot afford to repeat the mistakes which are made by others. We need to learn from mistakes of other states and take it forward. What we also learned that no country is fully prepared. Stronger health system gives an opportunity to be better, to give a better response. We have also learned in this pandemic that all those people who make argument for economic growth and then health is not an investment, they need to learn that how the pandemic has affected the economy of all the countries, including India. So investment in health is a investment in economic growth of a country. And finally, this is the last slide, that how to navigate in the pandemic. Each one of us has to play a role. Citizens need to follow COVID appropriate behavior. Every time, all the time, we need to get vaccinated, all those who are eligible. Government need to strengthen health system, prepare, raise awareness, and accelerate vaccination. Each one of us can contribute. We are sure that pandemic will be over. That is given. What it needs is that it should be over with the minimum damage, and we need to help each other, and we need to help fight the country to respond to this pandemic. Thank you very much, and I'm open to the questions from the audience.
Thank you so much, sir. This was truly an insightful presentation, and I'm sure the audience feels absolutely enlightened. So now we will move on with the Q&A session. I would like to welcome Sanmeet Singh to take over and handle the questions from the audience.
Yeah, before that, sir, it was very insightful session, and we have covered almost many of the questions which we got from the audience beforehand and during the live chat. So Sanmeet, make sure don't ask questions which was already addressed by sir during his presentation.
Yeah, sure. So for the first question I have, how can a layman stay updated about the recent developments in the pandemic without being overburdened by the information available?
So one of the key thing is that we need to follow some of the reliable sources, which are credible. So don't simply go by WhatsApp or social media information. At times, it's very difficult for layperson to identify which is credible and reliable. Now, I would say that the newspapers are accessed by majority of people, and some of the information given by experts in the newspaper is very reliable. All those who are techno savvy actually can go to Government of India, Ministry of Health and Family Welfare website, which provides some useful information, key questions. Similarly, the World Health Organization provides similar information. But what is important that people need to be aware that in their own setting and their own environment, what is the one reliable source of information? So they should ask somebody who they trust, who is from healthcare system. People can ask their healthcare provider, healthcare facility, or go to reliable sites. Sometimes the online sources, social media can create panic. It may be true, it may not be true, but we cannot take risk. Other part is that don't believe everything which is negative about the pandemic from everywhere. We are hearing a lot much information that children would be affected in third wave. That was completely wrong. Similarly, the Delta plus variant create a lot of panic. So for citizen, getting a right kind of information is useful, but don't panic. What we need to remember that no matter which variant it is, no matter which virus it is coming, as a citizen, we have to follow the COVID appropriate behavior, which will prevent us from any of the variant strain and get vaccinated. Also, the safety of vaccine is really proven. People have many misconceptions about the safety of vaccine, but what they need to know that vaccines are really safe, effective. They have followed a process. So don't go by misinformation about any aspect of vaccines. Read reliable sources.
Thank you, sir. For the next question, I have, how different is the experience and method of writing a book for the general audience versus that specifically for the medical fraternity?
So this was really challenging, but Dr. Guleria, Dr. Kang, and I personally thought that at the early part of pandemic, there was a lot of misinformation going on. There was many unknowns and people were really scared. So it became very clear in the early part of pandemic that while everybody would not get infected, but people were really, it was affecting their mental health because of infodemics, information epidemic through the social media. So we thought it's very relevant and important to provide them the reliable information. And that's the one for the purpose of our book, to provide them reliable and credible information in the layperson's language. So all three of us were busy, but then we also realized that this is something which need to be done. So time had to be found, and we found the time and we wrote the book. And I personally think it's one of the very satisfying thing in my life that I wrote and published a book, and people have found the book useful, where they, many of them use this as a reference book for key information on COVID-19 pandemic.
Yes, sir. So as a person with scientific temperament and training, how difficult is it to help develop policies for a country like India, where the population is so large and diverse in its beliefs? What are the challenges that you face here?
So I deliver talks on making policy for the poor and vulnerable. So that's a completely detailed explanation I have to give, but to summarize that whenever policies are being formed, we need to remember two things. One is that what impact that policy would have on the poorest, most marginalized and vulnerable person of the society. So health policy should be designed for the person who lives, let's say, a tribal widow, elderly, in a remotest part of Chhattisgarh or Jharkhand. If we can think as a policymaker that whether this policy would benefit that lady, tribal widow, elderly lady who stay alone in a remote village in the faraway corner of the country, then it probably benefit many other people. Second part is that every policy should have a focus upon increasing accessibility, increasing availability, improving quality, and increasing affordability of health services. So accessibility, availability, affordability, and quality, AAQI, and these four principles should be followed. So that's a broad principle. It's a challenging one. It takes time in the country, but everybody had to play the role in this three-way partnership between policymakers. If we have a committed policymakers, it can be expedited. If technical expert, medical doctors and public health expert can provide convincing evidence, if citizen as a agency start demanding for those services, so policymakers, health experts, and citizen work together, those kind of policies can be formulated. And some of the developments in policy formulation are really progressive. India launched a national rural health mission in 2005, and that has really contributed to improved access to healthcare services. Similarly, Ayushman Bharat program has been launched, which focus upon strengthening primary health centers across the country, primary healthcare system across the country. So it's a slow process, but it works well. The intention should be good.
Yeah, right. So as an allopathic healthcare provider, what is an appropriate stance to take when it comes to the multiple systems of medicine in our country, like Ayurveda, homeopathy, etc., especially in the context of the pandemic?
So what we need to remember that some of these medicines and pathies have evolved over a period of time. And each one is intended to do some of the specific purpose. In allopathy, majority of the curative medicine focus upon healing sick individual. But we also know that there are traditional systems of medicine which ensure that people stay healthy. They have a very useful and some of the role they have played in keeping people healthy, preventing and promoting diseases. So as long as people believe in a particular healthcare system, they should use that healthcare system. But what is key that individual practitioner should adopt or follow the particular system of medicine which they are trained. I'm trained in allopathic system of medicine, so I would prescribe or I would recommend only the allopathic system of treatment. So I should not try to use any other system which I'm not trained. Similarly, true for other systems of medicine. But I'm sure that people have been using these systems and there must have been some significant role, especially in the preventive promotive healthcare of various traditional medicines. So we as a society need to harmonize the role, and as a government should ensure that none of the systems should try to do something which it cannot achieve or where it is not proven.
So how has the knowledge and records of the previous pandemics in history helped you formulate the policies in COVID era?
Unfortunately, there has not been sufficient learning from the previous pandemics. Now, you would be surprised to know that the previous pandemic did not happen very long ago. Actually, the last pandemic was in the year 2009 and 10. So H1N1 pandemic of 2009 and 10, so only 11 or 12 years ago it happened. And we need to remember that we as a global community are getting closer to the next pandemic every passing day. This is happening because the faster modes of transport. So now a person can reach from one part of the world to another part of the world within 24 hours. So the virus or pathogen can also reach other parts. So then overcrowded cities where people are living closer. So that's a perfect ground for infectious diseases. Then third part is that deforestation. Deforestation is an important cause of bringing the pathogens, virus, and bacteria, which were till now hidden in the forest, coming in human context. And that's why the viruses and pathogens are approaching human beings and causing newer diseases. Climate change, which essentially means that the pathogens which were not able to survive in a particular condition can survive there longer. The single animal battery farming, which is where single animal is grown in the large area. Similarly, the indiscriminate use of antimicrobials, which is resulting in AMR, antimicrobial resistance. So there are many human behavior which are resulting in the pathogens causing entering in human environment and posing the risk of severe disease. And that's why we are closer to the epidemic, pandemics, or outbreaks every passing day. Unfortunately, we have not learned. One major learning which happened, that global community set up a coalition for epidemic preparedness and innovation in 2017. And with setting up of that coalition, what happened? That the current development of vaccine, COVID-19 vaccine, could be possible because that kind of learning was done and collaboration was established. I really hope that with this kind of pandemic, now there will be many more learnings, and not only learning, but there will be actions so to ensure that we are better prepared for epidemics and pandemics. We cannot stop outbreaks, epidemics, pandemics that much, but we can be better prepared so we can mitigate their impact.
So as you talked about the available vaccines in your presentation, what vaccines do you think will be available in the market for protection against the COVID waves caused by Delta variant?
All the vaccines which are currently available prevent from Delta variant as well. What we know that some of the vaccines, like on the laboratory study, the quantum of antibody required to neutralize the emerging variants is slightly higher. So we need to remember that the efficacy against the newer variant cannot be done in the similar way as it is done for other for the clinical trials before the licensing of vaccine. So one of the way to assess the effectiveness of vaccines or whether vaccines work against the emerging variant or not is a neutralizing antibody, which is done in laboratory setup. What has been found that against all these variants, emerging alpha, beta, gamma, delta, the existing vaccines, be it Pfizer, BioNTech, or Moderna, or Covishield, all vaccines are effective. They protect from these variants. However, it has been found that the amount of antibody required in to neutralize the new emerging variants is slightly higher. So this is not an immediate cause of concern, because another point is that somebody who develop, who get vaccination and then develop antibody, we really don't know currently the correlate of protection, which essentially means we don't know that how much level of antibody a person should have so that person can be considered protected. So if one person get after vaccination, let's say 50 on that unit of antibody, and another person get 500 on that particular unit of antibody. So from current scientific understanding, both person are equally protected, whether their antibody level is 50 or 500 or 5,000. So the variant requires slightly higher amount of antibody to neutralize. So it is being thought that with the people who have a relatively low antibody, person might be slightly less protected. But what we need to remember that in these vaccines, the protection is not by antibody only, but T cell mediated immune response is also there. So even if there is a very little antibody, but so the person can be protected by the other type of cell mediated immune response. So we really don't know. Current understanding is that vaccines are fully protective against emerging variants. Maybe there is one thought which is going on that once with the period of time antibody level goes down, so individual may require a booster shot. So the booster shot might be more useful to increase the quantum of antibody over a period of time, and so to provide protection against variants, but person might be protected for reasonably long. So our understanding is developing. Current understanding that don't worry about any variant, get the vaccine, it will protect you from that.
Now, people are forming these theories these days that those who are non-vaccinated are becoming the source of mutations, and who are vaccinated are becoming carriers in the case of COVID infection. Are these really considerable points or just myths?
So one of the things we need to remember that COVID-19 vaccines do not prevent from infection. What it means that a person who is vaccinated can still get infected. And if they will be tested, they might have a virus in their nose and throat. The vaccine provides protection from moderate to severe. That person will be infected, but person will not develop moderate to severe illness or will not die. So they prevent from hospitalization illnesses, and person can still get infected. That's why the individual need to wear face mask to get prevent themselves, but also because somebody who is vaccinated can still get infected. And that person, if not wearing face mask, can pass on to other person who is unvaccinated. And that unvaccinated person can develop full-fledged disease. So a vaccinated person is as much risky or pose a similar kind of risk to other person as unvaccinated person. So vaccination at initial stage provide individual level benefit. But once a large number of people are vaccinated, then the pool becomes smaller, and then it provides a large group benefit. So everybody is posing risk to other person, no matter whether the person is vaccinated or not vaccinated. Getting vaccinated will reduce that person's illness, and so people will be less infected, the transmission will be less. And also we believe that once people are vaccinated, the multiplication of virus in nose and throat, nasopharynx, back of the nose and throat, will be relatively less. So the viral load will be less and the risk of transmission will be less. But we really don't have to develop more understanding on the risk of transmission to other individual. The final part is that the risk of mutation is there till as long as virus is circulating all around us in India, in any part of the world. So unless pandemic is over from all parts of the world, we cannot be really sure. And the more the virus transmits, higher the risk of mutations. So we, to prevent mutation, to stop the emergence of variants of interest or concern, we actually have to stop the transmission. And the best way to stop the transmission is following COVID appropriate behavior and getting vaccinated in all parts of the world.
Right. So following up the previous question, what are the most common myths that normal people have to be aware of?
There are many myths. So people developed, there were many rumors that a vaccine causes infertility while it does not cause safe vaccine. There were myths that vaccine can cause magnetism in the individual. These are the tricks which people did. So it's difficult to answer all the myths here, but key is COVID appropriate behavior is a proven way of preventing infection. When people are going outside, they should follow physical distancing. As long as we are in the pandemic period, even if the number of cases have come down, we need to remember that even at the 40,000 cases in a day, the virus is still around us. Virus is circulating us, so everybody is at risk. Vaccines are safe. When we say vaccines are safe, there is a very minimal risk, very low level of risk, because anything which is foreign to our body, which is injected in our body, cannot be completely safe. There are some risks associated. There's a minor adverse event, but those risks are very, very minimal in comparison of the benefits provided. People are more likely to get severe illness and death after getting natural infection than any risk with the vaccine. So vaccines are safe, get vaccinated. My suggestion would be, because it's not difficult, it's not possible to answer all the myths. My suggestion is that whenever you come across any information, any doubt about vaccine or disease, ask a reliable source. Search for the reliable source of information, WHO, Government of India, Ministry of Health, ask a senior healthcare provider, ask somebody you trust and you will get answer for yourself.
As you said about reliable sources, can you mention a few reliable sources that you trust so that we can get information regarding the same?
So one is the Ministry of Health and Family Welfare website in India. Then second is a World Health Organization website where there's a detailed questions and answers. Third is a Center for Disease Control and Prevention in the United States, CDC. Fourth is a reliable and trustworthy source for any individual is in medical colleges, ask the people who are working, senior doctors. In community, ask a trustworthy doctor or healthcare provider. And even on social media, such as Twitter and other platforms, ask individuals who are reliable, who are trustworthy or widely known. I have a Twitter handle and many times people send me messages, direct message, even on Facebook. I respond to those questions. So ask somebody whom you trust, because in healthcare, reliable information, but trustworthy information, both are really essential and desirable.
So as we see more COVID cases, there are even more post-COVID-19 complications. How to manage these post-COVID complications?
So the post-COVID complications follow the similar pattern, which is a COVID symptoms. What happens that it has been found that many people, around one in every four person, even after 3 weeks or 4 weeks of infection, continue to have some of the symptoms, which could be very similar to the COVID-19 condition. There are 1 in 10 people who continue to have symptoms even after 12 weeks of infection. So these are called post-COVID or long COVID. Now, this can vary depending upon which organ of that individual was affected. This could be simply lethargy, fatigue, tiredness. So one of the things is that people need to eat healthy diet, take sufficient rest, and if there is a symptom persisting, consult a healthcare provider. What is also key that people should not immediately start physical activity or exertion a lot. Like they slowly need to adopt and follow the healthy behavior and listen to their body. So that's what they need to do. If there is a need, I think consult their healthcare provider. And the final point is that COVID-19 pandemic has reminded us one important thing, that there was no better time to stay healthy and fit than right now. If person has a severe illness, so like comorbidity, diabetes, hypertension, it is time that people should start getting effective control of those conditions. Staying healthy has incentive in COVID-19 pandemic period.
Right. So now, as medical students are going into internship, what are the new updates on hospital infection control protocols that we should know about?
I would say that follow COVID appropriate behavior, wear your mask and learn about it, how to follow those behavior, make that habit. Second part is that I believe that healthcare facilities, unless somebody is working in a directly in the COVID-19 ward or patients, then they need to follow the PP and other approach. But there is no need of being really excessively worried and concerned. As long as individual follow COVID appropriate behavior and especially get vaccinated, all those who are 18 year plus, it should not be an issue. I do understand that it is a cause of mental stress for many families, parents and students. Reading, knowing the behavior and going into this process will help. If somebody somebody is excessively worried, they should consult either faculty member or a counselor and get their doubts cleared. Most important in such setting is that having worry and concerns, apprehensions is so natural. But we have learned a good deal about COVID-19 pandemic, and our understanding is that that if people follow this COVID appropriate behavior, they are unlikely to develop disease. Once they are vaccinated, they are unlikely to develop infection, and then they are protected. But we also need to remember that the pandemic is here at least for some more months. And then even when pandemic will be over, the virus is going to be with us. So we need to adapt to that kind of lifestyle. Being worried is part of that process, but we should take necessary steps. We should try to understand the cause of worry and take corrective measures. Like there is no harm. And I have been writing regularly that one of the recognition, one of the findings from this pandemic is that mental health needs are far higher than the available services. And these mental health needs are for everyone, me, you, anybody, doctor, nursing, community members. So government need to have those kind of mental health services. We should not hesitate if we have doubt in asking and seeking mental health services support.
So due to COVID-19, many people started to embrace the idea of healthy lifestyle and practices related to Ayush. These have seen significant growth curve and have been included in the new internship guidelines of MBBS students as well. So to what extent should we as doctors should respect and answer the queries regarding to other practices of medicine?
I think I would prefer not to answer those questions. I would answer what I've been taught and what I have learned. But there are some of the basic principles, some principle which about staying healthy. Like if somebody tells me that you should stay hydrated and drink water, I have no problem. Like you should do some breathing exercise. I know there is no harm in it. These are traditional knowledge. On those advice, eat healthy. And now you can say this is some system or some science, but of course, these are the basic principles of staying healthy. On that, we can answer. But something which is require specialized knowledge, I would not answer, and I don't think mere exposure in that area empower anyone to answer those questions. So as a medical doctor, as somebody who is fresh graduate, I strongly encourage that they should follow the system. They should practice the knowledge which they have been taught, not something which really they don't know. That's not the right thing. But the principles of healthy lifestyle, healthy eating, sleep well, are universal. You don't like, of course, the people want to hear these from a qualified doctor, but this does not require a doctor. If I tell somebody eat fresh fruits, if he or she can afford, all I need to know that whether I'm giving advice to somebody who can afford it or not. But beyond that, we know that this will help, so that's fine. But something which requires only a qualified training, that should not be done by those who are not trained to do so.
Yes, sir. Sir, do you have any urgent meeting? Like, usually involved in many meetings, right? Is it okay to take till 8:30 p.m. the session?
I think we can go on. Yeah, sure.
Okay, sir. Sanmit, only ask the few important questions which I have sent in chat box.
Okay, so now I will be asking questions from the delegates. So, sir, is it true that people who are vaccinated, there are possible for Guillain-Barré syndrome? If yes, which all people are more prone to the disease by this autoimmune disease?
So Guillain-Barré syndrome is a very rare event. Now, we need to remember that whenever vaccine safety is assessed or examined, we always need to know that what is the baseline rate of that particular condition and what is happening in the vaccinated individual. Now, it is very likely, the globally 200 crore doses of various COVID-19 vaccines have been administered. Now, in many of these, in some of these individual, 200 crore individual, even when if the vaccine was not administered, some of them might have developed Guillain-Barré syndrome. And so it would not be fair that we call it that vaccine are causing this syndrome, Guillain-Barré syndrome. It's a rare, but happens from different parts of the world. To my knowledge, there is no evidence that COVID-19 vaccine are associated with this kind of syndrome. We also need to remember that adverse event following immunization is mainly like anything which happens temporarily. Temporarily means if today somebody given vaccine, and after that person develop any health condition, no matter for what reason, it is called adverse event. So if somebody get vaccination and after a few days, like even up to 6 weeks or even longer period, if people report any condition, this would be investigated and then a causation is established. Now, what we need to remember, what happens in majority of the condition, that if a person who is not vaccinated as a routine, they have a health condition, they are less likely to follow that, report that health condition. But once person is vaccinated, they become more aware and alert about that condition, more likely to report. But cut the long story short, there is no association has been found between COVID-19 vaccines and Guillain-Barré syndrome.
Right. So, okay. Next question is, why is it that new variants of concern have been on rise since this year? And relatively, there was not such an interest in variants in previous year.
No, rather, all four variants, alpha, beta, gamma, delta, were first reported last year. The delta variant was first reported in October 2020 in Maharashtra state of India. So the delta variant was first reported from India. The alpha variant was first reported in September 2020 in Kent, England. Gamma variant was first reported in May 2020, and then beta variant was first reported in May 2020, and gamma variant was reported in December. So all of the variants which are causing disease now were first reported in 2020, not in 2021. But what we need to know that these mutations keep happening in the virus, especially this virus. So every mutation is not relevant. But by the time the clinical association between that mutation and the clinical association in the mutation and change has been reported, it is relatively a few months, because every change which happens is not significant. Only when it's clinically relevant, it's significant. So these mutations, the current variants of concerns first reported last year. There are variants of interest which have been reported this year. And it takes some time. Like they are termed as a concern only when they identify some characteristic. As long as virus is circulating, as long as there is a transmission, there is a risk of mutations, which can be variants of interest or concern.
Okay. Now, suppose a patient is fully vaccinated and got infected. Will the immunity take more longer time to wane than the patient who are vaccinated but did not catch infection?
We really don't know fully, but most likely, yes. Because what has been found in some of the studies that individuals who had a past infection, previous infection, and then they were administered vaccines, the amount of antibody produced in those individuals with the past infection was far higher. Now, current understanding is that those who have a little higher antibody, because antibody decline at a particular pace, might have a longer lasting protection. But we really don't know, because the protection in the COVID-19 is really complex. We know that even without antibody, with the antibody going down, person can be protected through cell-mediated immunity, as I highlighted earlier.
Okay. So now I would like to hand over to Tarun Sovri, sir. He can take up next questions.
Sir, we have last few interesting questions. Like one such question is, like, sir, we have seen few cases in children where there is an occurrence of mortality. Like, can you suggest any exact pathophysiology or some sort of information supporting that children are less vulnerable for COVID-19?
So, one thing which I highlighted, and I have written a piece in Times of India, which can be accessed online. And the factor is that the children are equally vulnerable. They can get infection at the same rate as the adults, because virus is all around us. So the virus can grow in their, can be nose and throat of those children. But to make individuals sick, the virus need to travel to lungs. Now, then the virus travels to lungs, and then lungs, it multiply again, and then travels to other parts of the body where it will show symptoms. But in children, the receptors through which virus can enter into lungs are underdeveloped and insufficient. And that is the reason that the children do not develop severe disease, because virus does not get the port of entry into children. Now, the symptoms are very similar in children or at all age groups. They are not very different. But what has been found that only those children who have a pre-existing health condition, who are sick, who are under treatment, are at risk of developing moderate to severe COVID-19 illness. A very rare condition has been found, reported in children, called multisystem inflammatory syndrome of children, MISC, MISSI. But this is again very rare, and this also happens in those children which are have a pre-existing conditions. What also need to be remembered, that since the name itself suggests the multi-system inflammatory syndrome, which essentially means it can affect more than one organ. And we know pathophysiology of SARS-CoV-2, that it can cause immune failure, like up or down regulation, that our immune system either does not function and then people fall sick, or in some cases it functions excessively, which is called cytokine storm and other parts. So we really don't know. And then other organs, different organs are affected. What we need to remember, though this is a respiratory virus for all age groups, it does not cause only respiratory illnesses. It can cause multi-system illnesses. Various parts of the body and organs are affected.
Yes, sir. We have today our last two questions. The first question is, sir, what happens if cross vaccination happens? Like, suppose a person has taken the Covishield first dose but then taken Covaxin a second dose, like, is there anything happen? And also, sir, please address this question also, like, there are many mixed vaccines, like Mixed vaccines are currently in process of pipeline. Can you please add a note on it?
So one thing is that in immunologically, nothing would happen if a different vaccine is administered at second dose. There is no possibility. The worst case scenario would be that immune response may not be sufficient. We really don't know what would happen if Covishield vaccine is given and followed by a Covaxin, or a Covaxin is given followed by Covishield, but there would not be, there is no probability or very, there is theoretically no probability of any harmful effect. The benefit could be less. But there are studies which have been done on mixing of the vaccine, in the sense like a first vaccine, a different one, and second vaccine, different one, like Oxford AstraZeneca vaccine, which is Covishield in India, and Pfizer BioNTech vaccine and other vaccines. And what have been found that when second shot of the different vaccine is given, especially mRNA vaccine, the amount of antibody produced with the that kind of different vaccine is far higher than the same vaccine is given. In the medical science language, this is called a heterologous prime boost approach. And this approach has been, some studies have been done on heterologous prime boost approach in Spain, United Kingdom. In fact, some of the countries are exploring going for a different vaccine for second shot to get a higher amount of antibody. Bhutan, our neighboring country, was given Covishield vaccine by India, which they administered the first shot, and now the Covishield vaccine is not available. So Bhutan is requesting other countries to donate whichever vaccine they have, and they will use that vaccine. So vaccine can be given interchangeably. Some vaccines have been studied, but not Covishield and Covaxin.
Yes, sir. With that, we are ended with these questions. I request Toshani to proceed for the vote of thanks.
So now that we come to the end of the session, I would once again like to extend my deepest gratitude to Dr. Laheria, sir, for taking out time from his busy schedule and enlightening us and answering all these questions put forth by our audience. Thank you so, so much, sir, for your time. It has truly been a great learning experience for all of us. I would also like to thank our lovely audience for tuning in for this session. Hope to see you all in the consequent sessions. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Sir, please stay for 5 minutes, sir. We can have a group photo. I will end the streaming.